Ladies and gentlemen, please turn your attention to the field where we have a special presentation as we honor our 2012 Inter Soccer seniors. Florida's 2012 senior class has amassed a four-year record of 63 wins, 19 losses, and 6 draws. A 750 winning percentage, which ranks as the nation's 6th highest number of wins over the last 4 seasons. They have been a part of 2 SEC title teams and advanced to NCAA play each of the last 3 seasons. First, we would like to welcome team manager Sean Tracy. Sean has been an integral part of the Inter Soccer program during his time as manager. He has aided in several different areas from practice and game setup to videography. He is also a member of the UF Men's Club Soccer Team. Escorted today by his parents, Matt and Jerry, and his brother Dylan, ladies and gentlemen, Sean Tracy. Our next senior is from Tampa, Florida, number 14, Joe Tregata. Joe has played in 73 matches with 24 starts, with 4,145 minutes played, 3 goals, 10 assists, and 16 points. Scored 3 goals as a senior, including Friday's game winner in the 85th minute versus number 14, Missouri. Set career high of season points with 9 as a senior from defensive midfield position. 2011 Southeastern Conference All-Tournament Team Selection, SCC Academic Honor Roll member. Joe graduated May of 2013 with a degree in anthropology. Escorted by her parents Art and Rosemary, along with other family members, ladies and gentlemen, Joe Tregata. Academic Honor Roll as a sophomore and junior. Named to the SEC Community Service Team as a sophomore. She will graduate in May of 2013 with a degree in elementary education. Holly is escorted by her parents, Chuck and Gail, along with other family members. Ladies and gentlemen, Holly Kane. Minutes played, 26 goals, 33 assists, and 85 2011 NSCAA All-American Second Team. 2009, 2010, and 2011 NSCAA All-South Region Team Member. 2010 and 2011 All-Southeastern Conference First Team and 2010 SEC Tournament MVP. NSCAA National Player of the Week for the final week of August 2012 after Golden Goal versus Duke. Led the SEC in assists with 13 as a sophomore, and that total ranked tied for 6th in final national rankings. Three-time SEC Offensive Player of the Week, earning honors as a sophomore, junior, and senior. On UF career list, tied for 4th in assists with 33, 7th for points with 85, and tied for 9th with goals with 26. On the 2012 Missouri Athletic Club's Herman Trophy watch list and a candidate for Lowe's Senior Class Award. SEC Academic Honor Roll member. She will graduate in December of 2012 with a degree in criminology, escorted today by her parents Dave and Gina, along with other family members. Ladies and gentlemen, Erica Timrath. Matches with 78 starts, 6,776 minutes played with 2 assists. Two-time NSCAA All-American, earning second-team honors in 2010 and third-team in 2011. 2010 and 2011 NSCAA All-South Region first-team selection. 2010 Southeastern Conference Defensive Player of the Year. 2010 and 2011 All-SEC First Team, and named to SEC All-Tournament Team in same year. Twice named SEC Defensive Player of the Week as a junior. Second on Gators' career complete matches played chart with 59. Started every match of collegiate career up to the injury suffered in early September. On the 2012 Missouri Athletics Club Herman Trophy watch list and candidate for Lowe's Senior Class Award. 2010 and 2011 NSCAA Scholar All-American First Team. SEC Academic Honor Roll selection as a redshirt freshman, sophomore, and junior. She will graduate in December of 2012 with a degree in psychology, escorted by her mother, Carolyn, and sister, Carrie. Ladies and gentlemen, Catherine Williamson.
Yeah. We welcome you to Gainesville and James G. Presley Stadium, the site today of SEC soccer. Number 12, Florida plays host to Mississippi State. Just four games remain in the SEC slate. And as we take a look at the SEC East, it is Florida leading not only the Eastern Division, but leading the overall picture as well after their win against Missouri on Friday night. Meanwhile, in the West, Mississippi State needs some help to get into Orange Beach, Alabama. They have a win and a tie so far in SEC play. As we welcome you to our broadcast, great to have you with us alongside Cameron Broom. I'm Bernie Gunther. Cameron, two teams in opposite directions right now. Florida trying to hone in on an SEC regular season title. Meanwhile, we see Mississippi State. They need just some wins just to get into Orange Beach, Alabama.
Yes, Florida has done a great job staying atop the Eastern Division. Mississippi State needs a little bit of help today and make sure that they can get a win today in order to get them to Orange Beach.
Well, last year in Starkville, Mississippi State pulled off a big-time upset, and the big reason was Skylar Ross, and man, she was outstanding in goal.
Yes, last year against Florida, Skylar had 13 saves. She's a great athletic keeper. She's done a great job having 74 saves this year for Mississippi State.
On the other side, for the Florida Gators, they got a good one themselves, inside goal, Taylor Burke. She not only is a great goalkeeper, but also the SEC outdoor high jump champion.
Yes, that shows you how athletic she is. She's quick and she has a great reach. She's kept Florida in a lot of games this year.
It's Florida, Mississippi State, just four games left in SEC play. It's senior day here in Gainesville. We'll have starting lineups when we come back. Number 12, Florida hosting Mississippi State. Glad to have you with us at James G. Presley Stadium in Gainesville today for SEC soccer. Let's check out the starters today for the Bulldogs of Mississippi State. A 4-3-3. Sullivan is their leading scorer. You can look forward to her up top. 9 goals, 4 assists. The back line, Irby Grimms and Jenna Dean, Jordan and Rawson in goal for Neil McDonald in his 9th season. He started off in Starkville as an assistant coach in 2003 and became the head coach in 2004. Yeah, let's check out the starters today for the Florida Gators. 11-3-1 and 8-1 in the SEC. Their lineup of 4-2-3-1. Mackenzie Barney up top. Salon, Timrak, Spies, Dragata, King in the midfield. Silver, Westfall, Bobbitt, and Rogers, the defenders, and Taylor Burke in goal for Becky Burley, who is in search of her 12th SEC regular season title. Last year, it went to South Carolina, Cameron, and this team obviously controls their own destiny now after taking out the front runners, Texas A&M, last weekend in Missouri on Friday night. But certainly based on what we found out last year, this is a game that they can't get out of their mind, because last year in Starkville, Mississippi State did defeat Florida.
I don't think there's a game in the SEC that you can take for granted, because those 3 points that you get for a win are so important to every single team. And this is one of those games. You can't overlook a Mississippi State on a Sunday. You know, we've talked about in the past how traveling on Sundays is difficult for the away team, and the home team has a little bit of an advantage. But you also have to account for the fact that this is a big game. I think Florida's going to come prepared for a couple of reasons. They, like you said, control their own destiny. But today is also senior day, so I think they have a lot to play for these seniors that are going to be leaving them at the end of this year.
Yeah, certainly an emotional day here. You remember your time back as an SEC athlete. What were the emotions like knowing that this could be the final home game of your career?
I think there's a variety of emotions. I think you're excited because you get to play in front of this home fan base one more time. But I think it's a little bit sad, too, knowing that this could be the last time that you're playing on this field. Hopefully not. Hopefully that, you know, they might be able to host some games maybe in the tournament. But this, knowing that this could be that, I think it makes you want to win that much more.
And the two seniors, part of SEC regular season titles in 2009 and 2010, It was kind of a topsy-turvy season for Florida. You talk about the way they started out with a loss at Miami, and after that they've really bounced back. And meanwhile, for Mississippi State, they won 8 games in a row before losing 7 in a row and getting a win against Alabama on Friday night to finally lose, break that losing streak. And the one eye, certainly for Florida, as far as the defenders are concerned, has to be on Elizabeth Sullivan, number 2, the junior from Memphis, Tennessee. Last year, 37 seconds into the ball game, she scored the second fastest goal in school history. There she is in the maroon for the Bulldogs. And she's one of only 2 players from Mississippi State who has scored in SEC play.
Well, not only that, she had those 2 goals on Friday night against Alabama, that one being a game-winning goal. She's an important factor for the Mississippi State team. She needs to make sure that she comes out ready to play today in order for them to have an opportunity to win this game against Florida.
Sullivan helped lead Mississippi State to their first road win since last year in October. Florida leads the all-time series. They're a perfect 7-0 in Gainesville as we are underway SEC soccer on a Sunday. And certainly, the Gators weary of the quick start that Mississippi State had last year as we see Simmons play the ball back, and Florida has the ball after the initial push by the Bulldogs.
Yeah, I'm sure that Coach Burley reminded them in the locker room of that quick start last year. So that they made sure they were ready for that.
Salon lost it, and it's cleared out of bounds by Amy Hoover, the sophomore from Brookhaven, Mississippi. You certainly never talk about trap games. You expect that the teams are always up for it, but as we see the ball played out wide to Mackenzie Barney, and Florida try to possess it in the offense. What is it like when you come off as a player, one of those big time signature wins on a Friday night, and especially in the grueling SEC slate where you have to play Friday, Sunday?
Friday, Sunday is always a difficult turnaround for any players.
Salon inside the box, and it's gonna roll out of bounds, and the Gators are gonna have the first set piece. Oh no, they're gonna wave it off and say it'll be a goal kick coming. It's the middle of October, but 86 degrees here in Gainesville, so no break for the Bulldogs traveling down from Starkville.
No, I think playing at Florida is always a difficult task. You know, it's Sunday, it's hot. It's hotter than most teams are used to. But I think Florida, you know, had a great win on Friday night. But they have to refocus and gather themselves again for a tough Sunday game. Sunday games are always hard because it's easier to play on a Friday night under the lights. And so I think that, you know, both of these teams have to focus today.
Grimm's the defender looking for help to McKee. This is Shelby Jordan, the freshman from Jackson, Tennessee. Neil McDonald is a very young team. Haley Helpsley. Barney tried to win it, but some good defense by Grimm's. Timrek off the back of her foot to Spies. A lot of space for Amy Hoover. Maloney. Offside flag is up on Jasmine Simmons. 1 goal this year. She had 4 scores in SEC play as a junior and finished 2nd on the team. Big storyline as we move along in the postseason. We'll see a whistle and it'll be a free kick for Florida. You're obviously at this point trying to get to Orange Beach, Alabama. It's going to be an expanded tournament this year now with 14 teams in the league. But with a win worth 3 points and a tie worth just a point, Mississippi State, that's their biggest issue right now, is a lack of points to try to get into that tournament. So you may see the Bulldogs a little more aggressive today trying to get ahead early, because they need the 3 points.
Yes, we talked about, you know, the importance of those 3 points. But for Mississippi State being at the bottom and not having, you know, enough points currently to get into Orange Beach, that has to be in the back of their minds. They know they need those 3 points. They know they have to win in order to advance. And you play this regular – you play your regular season to get into your conference play, and you play your conference play to get you prepared to go to the SEC tournament. And that's where they want to be at the end of this regular SEC season.
Annie Spies tried to make the penetration herself with dribbling against the Bulldog defense. Instead, a whistle against Mississippi State is going to give Florida a free kick. Westfall gets it back in play quickly. Here is Erica Timrak. Timrak fed through and onsides the shot, and Mackenzie Barney strikes first in the fifth minute of action. A beauty of a goal set up by Erica Timrak. And Mackenzie Barney did a brilliant job of just staying on sides.
She did. Erica Timrak did a great job, and all of the Florida players recognizing this would be a quick restart. She sees Mackenzie Barney run along the line of those defenders. She does that, takes one great touch, and finds the back post. Great job by Florida collectively.
Florida's lone forward with her fifth goal in 2012. And that's the biggest difference. You take a look at Florida and the way they spread out their goal scoring. Barney and Havana Salon, the only two with five goals on the season. There's Barney, the senior. And outside of that, they've just really done a great job of spreading out who is the one that's finishing for them. And that's a good sign for a team, especially when you're Coach Becky Burley and you're looking for the goal scorer, to know that you have a number of players that have been getting it done on the season.
What it also is great for is knowing when you go up against defenders that they have to be worried about more than just one person.
Barney in the corner tried to connect with Salon. Florida's very patient in the attack. They like to play an indirect style of soccer and keep possession. Dragata Salon back to Barney, looking for her second goal across the mouth of the goal. And Silver, the defender, is going to win it back in the corner. Silver is Heltzley has the defense. It'll be a goal kick. You can check out SEC Sundays at 2 Eastern for SEC volleyball. Next week, volleyball action, South Carolina and Ole Miss on CSS at 2 p.m. Eastern. After a lot of soccer on the air, we turn our attention to volleyball on the Sunday afternoons. It's amazing to think that it's senior day here and how quickly the SEC season does go by. Timrak to Barney, the goal scorer. Back to Timrak. Timrak fires a shot, and it just misses the near post.
It was a great combination play between Barney and Timrak. They've done, you know, they did it well earlier to get the goal, and here you see Barney, you know, just pass that ball just again right behind those defenders, and Florida's doing a great job of running that line and making sure that they stay onside.
Timrak's now in sole possession, fourth on Florida's career assist chart, 34 career assists after assisting on that goal by Mackenzie Barney. And man, you just love to have players that are as unselfish as an Erica Timrak is, and making sure, you know, the goal scorer oftentimes may get the credit in the fans' view, but the one that sets it up, man, they are so important.
And Erica Timrak does a great job of, she's quick on the ball, she's great at 1v1, so she's able to beat defenders and then get her head up and find her teammates' feet. And it is such a great accomplishment for her to move up the assist charts all time for Florida. But she is a talented player.
Plenty of space. Annie Bobbitt is going to bring it up from the back and try to play it through to Lauren Silver, the defender who was getting in on the attack. Seems like you talk to the coaches around the SEC, more and more we see that strategy of we really want to get our outside backs into the attack.
Yeah, I think Florida is a team that you can look at and really see how effective it can be. Becky Burley is known for sending those outside backs high as they can get. I mean, a lot of times you'll look up and you'll think that they're an additional forward. They get so high. But it works. It creates havoc for the defense. It's one more number that they have to take care of up top, and it makes your opposing defenders be very, very organized to account for those people that are running in.
It'll be a steep throw in near midfield. Hoover tried to settle it. And Florida plays it well. They played it right to the feet of Spies, but she gave it back away. Here's Timrak. Overlapping run on the other side. As Maggie Rogers is going to earn the corner. Rogers, a junior from Gulf Breeze, Florida. And Florida quickly gets the ball back in, and Timrak has the ball taken away from her by Elizabeth Sullivan. And then Sullivan takes a wicked hit just outside the box as well. A physical game early on here, 10 minutes into action.
I'll find out. He says
you always got to be careful as a defender whenever you make a tackle inside the penalty area, the 18-yard box.
I think there was a little bit of panic there from Mississippi State. Florida played that corner very quickly. They kind of caught Mississippi State on their heels. And I was kind of surprised there wasn't a call because it looked like she came in directly from behind of Timrak. But that's one thing that we're going to see. These teams, you know, when we talk about the importance of winning a game, it can get a little bit chippy at times, and teams are going to be very physical.
Timrak right down the middle is tripped up, and Florida's going to have a direct free kick.
You see, Erica does a great job. She loves to take people on 1v1, and at times you're going to have people come in and kind of hack at you. And unfortunately for Mississippi State, it results in a set piece, which Florida is very good and very dangerous.
Lauren Morgan, the redshirt senior, is going to be given a yellow card. Dragata and Annie Spies over the ball here. I'd assume they're going to make the wall move back a little bit.
You know, that's one thing. You actually have to ask for your 10 yards. Then they'll stop the play. And then now Florida will have to wait until the whistle blows in order for them to restart.
Annie Spies fires it on goal. This one's still bouncing around the box, but you see Skylar Rawson last year recording an SEC best, 131 saves, 13 saves against the Gators last year, come up with a brilliant save here.
Yeah, she does a great job. That side of the goal was supposed to be covered by the wall, and it was a great ball by Amy Spies, but Skylar does a great job of just getting out and just getting enough of her fingertips on it to keep it out of the net.
And Mackenzie Barney nearly had a chance for goal number two of the ball game. Look at Timrak combined with Salon. Out to Timrak, fires a shot, and Rawson right on it. But they are testing the senior keeper for the Bulldogs early and often in this one.
That was a great series again. Erica Timrak combining. We talk about she's high on the assist charts, but she does a great job of combining with her teammates, and not only combining with them, but doing it in one-touch fashion. Just, you know, a little 1-2s back and forth, and again, Florida gets in.
She recorded, Skylar Rawson recorded a program best 549 consecutive scoreless minutes, helping lead Mississippi State to that 8-0 start to the season, where they won their first 8 games in a row before tying South Carolina in conference action. Silver settles it down. It's off the knees of Helsley.
Let's get out of here. Come on.
Five shots for Florida. The Bulldogs have yet to really move the ball into their offensive third in this ball game.
I know we've seen them kind of get stuck in here a little bit and keep the ball in Florida's end while Florida's trying to throw the ball in, but they really need to settle down, knock the ball around a little bit, keep the ball. As long as Mississippi State has possession of the ball, then Florida can't score and can't get on the attack, and that's what they're lacking right now, is that ability to keep possession of the ball.
They play it back to the feet, Florida's keeper, Taylor Burke, the SEC Outdoor Champion. She also won the USA Junior Championship high jump title. 10 feet, 10 and 3 quarters of an inch, earning a spot at the World Junior Track and Field Championships in Barcelona, Spain. Florida tries to play it over the top, and Barney can't settle it. It was an opportunity for the Bulldogs for the moment, but Westfall came up and won the ball. Tim Rack working in possession, and the whistle's going to go against Florida. It will be a free kick for Mississippi State. Shanine Janodine, the sophomore from Scarborough, Ontario. And a physical battle so far with Tim Rack in this game early on.
Yeah, I think that's something that we're going to see throughout the game. I think both teams are going to be physical because, you know, we talked about it's important for Mississippi State to win this game. But, you know, Florida, with senior day, it's a big deal for them, too. And they want to make sure that they're giving their all today for those seniors. And so I think we will see a battle on the field. They're going to battle individually and battle as a team.
Amy Hoover got the deflection off our referee today, Fernando Calvin. And a whistle against the Gators. A free kick coming for the Bulldogs. And this is where things, you never know how dangerous a free kick inside midfield could be, just because if you can serve the ball well enough inside that 18-yard box, anything can happen.
Right, you want to be organized offensively so that as the ball gets played in, you're making sure to kind of make the goal a little bit bigger by extending it on each side, but also making sure you have runs into the box. And right there, we didn't see any runs going into the box for Mississippi State, and the result was that it was an easy ball for Taylor Burke to collect.
You can join your favorite talking football experts as they give their latest analysis on football season around the South and around the country. Tune into Talking Football Sundays at 8 Eastern and Talking SEC Football presented by Cook's Pest Control Wednesday at an all-new time, 7 p.m. Eastern, only on CSS. Bulldogs have one possession. Helsley has a momentary possession that they won. The Gators have done such a good job through the first half of this game possessing the ball. That makes things awfully difficult. As Silver was making an overlapping run, and she was left all alone, and they finally found her, but maybe a moment too late, as Janodine was able to clear it out of play. It's always difficult when those defenders get up on the attack, especially if you forget to mark them. This is Spies. Bulldogs try to clear upfield. And that was one that maybe Mississippi State would have liked to have seen played out.
You know, Florida has done a good job of possessing the ball, and I think that's what has enabled them to stay on the attack more, is when they're changing the point of attack, and they're making sure that they're not just going down one side. They're okay with it. They start to go down one side, and it doesn't look like it's going to work. They're going to pull the ball back and keep possession of it rather than force anything. And I think that's going to be important for them as this game goes on, to make sure that, you know, if Mississippi State is able to get numbers behind the ball, that they're patient. They don't need to rush anything or try to force anything.
Sullivan right to the keeper's feet. Taylor Burke has possession. And Simmons will finally make her pick it up. That Porter will elect to play the ball back up from their defense. Annie Bobbitt now in possession. Out of bounds, a throw in for Porter just outside their offensive third, halfway through the first half. Mackenzie Barney has maybe made Becky Burley on her birthday smile a little bit early on in this game with an early goal. Silver combining with Barney. Here's Silver trying to chip it across. Ball headed out of the box. East trying to keep it in. Instead, here is Helsley the other way. And Bobbitt and Florida have earned possession once again. Good step up by Grimms to win the 50-50 ball, but take it away as Westfall wins it back for Florida. Here's Timrak. Timrak to Barney, who scored the first goal, and it's played out of bounds off of Dunedin. And it'll be a Florida corner kick.
Mississippi State needs to be careful when they give these corners up to Florida. Florida is so good in the air, and they've scored numerous goals this season off corner kicks, and they don't want to just give them an opportunity to take a free shot at their goal.
Annie Spies will take the corner. Silver has the ball with a lot of room. Is going to chip it back in, and look at Rawson come out and rip it from the sky. Right out of the grasp of Mackenzie Barney, who was hoping to get ahead on it.
And Skylar Rawson is not afraid to be physical on goal. And here we see Silver does a great job, plays this ball back in the box. Mackenzie Barney gets in there. You almost think that she's going to be able to pull it away from Rawson. But Rawson does a good job to come down on top of the ball and make sure that she gets a handle on it.
Maybe an opportunity here for the Bulldogs. You'd like to see them possess the ball a little bit better. It seems like they can't string together any more than two passes at a time before Florida regaining possession.
And that's something you know coming in when you play Florida. They're going to play a lot of high pressure. They're going to make sure that you work for the ball. They love to possess the ball, and they do a good job of it. They're not afraid to settle the ball down and knock it around. And that's what we need to see from Mississippi State. We need them to gather themselves and just knock the ball around a little bit before they try to go on the attack, because that final pass just isn't linking up with a teammate for them.
Grimes had it taken away. Annie Spies had the deflection, won it back. Doesn't look like Florida has numbers, but a lot of room for Salon, and Salon goes right up the middle of the field. Here's Barney chipping it across the mouth of the goal, and Timrak had it deflected right to Rawson. So a reverse of how the first goal scored, with Timrak getting assist on Barney's goal. Barney trying to play the favor there for Timrak, but credit Rawson coming off her line and taking that away.
Well, and you said Florida didn't have numbers, but they weren't afraid to go ahead and get on the attack. Mississippi State needs to match up with those numbers a little bit better, make sure that they're a little bit tighter and more organized defensively in order to prevent attacks like that coming from Florida.
Barney. King. Timrak back to King. Can she get there in time? She does. And here's Barney with plenty of space in the corner to work. Barney chips it across the mouth of the goal. It's going to be cleared out by Jana Dean. But Florida throwing again inside their offensive third. Look at all the room for King to work. Timrak. Timrak fires a shot. And the Bulldogs are lucky there was no handball call there, as that one came flying through. Here's Silver. to Spies. Spies into the box, firing it across. It'll go out of bounds. We got a timeout on the field, 22 minutes, 40 seconds to play. And it's the Florida Gators with the early lead. Mackenzie Barney with the score early on. Timrak with the assist. And it's the Gators leading the Bulldogs by a quarter.
Ladies, why is your man watching this snoozer of a game? Because I'm on his fantasy football team. So he gets for 10 points if we win or not. Boom! It's a guy thing. Like Dr. Pepper 10. With all 23 flavors of Dr. Pepper and just 10 manly calories, it's like a fantasy soda. But you can drink it.
Get in there, hot dog!
It's what guys want. Like scoring touchdowns with players that fake coaching. So close. So keep the reality TV and lady drinks. We're good.
Dr. Pepper 10. It's not for women.
As the Civil War raged,
Neil McDonald and Mississippi State coming off a Friday night win 3-2 against Alabama, but they trail Florida early on here after we see Mackenzie Barney with the fastest goal of the season in the fifth minute for Becky Burley and the Florida Gators. But one of the advantages to being on television, as we heard the coaches last week talk about, that breaking the games into four quarters, if you will, is the opportunity to basically bring the team over and maybe regroup a little bit. And what do you think, adjustment-wise, Mississippi State is thinking about early on in this game?
I think Coach McDonald is telling his team that they need to be a little bit more sound defensively. They need to make sure that they keep numbers behind the ball and don't panic when Florida gets the ball. It seems like they're allowing Florida to do simple one-twos to get around them defensively, and they can't have that happen. They need to make sure that they're playing good, solid defense.
Adriana Leon into the ball game for Florida as we see Haderi into the ball game the other way. And Mary Catherine Taylor, the freshman from Pace, Florida, had an opportunity, and Taylor Burke came off her line. And the first real dangerous chance for Mississippi State is both teams making some substitutions there at that break. Just trying to get some fresh legs on. It'll roll out of bounds. It'll be a goal kick coming for Mississippi State, but you gotta like the extra surge that Mary Catherine Taylor and Hania Haderi, both freshmen, made for this young Bulldog team after the break.
Well, we talked about, you know, the traveling and how hard those Sunday games are for the away team. And I think that can be a factor here for Mississippi State. It's warmer than they're probably used to. They're practicing in you know, weather that's a little bit different than this, but you know, it's going to be hard for them. They're going to need to keep fresh legs on the field in order for them to be able to pressure Florida the way that they need to be able to win this game.
King to Timrak as Florida's one possession. Hania Haderi trying to apply some pressure on that back line, and look at the big step up there for Madison McKee, winning the ball for the moment. And Sullivan continues to try to fight through after her two goals on Friday night. And Gino Dean chipped it in the box, but all the way to the Gator keeper.
Get it, Maggie! Find a way!
The Gators have outshot the Bulldogs 6-0 early on in this ball game, as Lauren Morgan tried to earn possession for the Bulldogs. Leon, the transfer from Notre Dame, had to take it away. Taylor, the freshman. Leon won it back for the moment. And off the back of her foot, Leon to Claire Faulkner. Faulkner inside the penalty area. And Janardine took it back for the Bulldogs. A lot of contact early on in this game.
It has been. It's been a physical game, and I think, you know, that just shows the fight that these two teams have. You know, every game in the SEC should be a battle, and we want to get the top teams in the SEC and the bottom teams in the SEC to come tighter together to make this conference better. And I think that's how you see it begin, is these teams battling each other every day, that they come ready to play. And I think it's a good sign in the SEC when you see tough games.
Man, maybe it's still going to be a throw-in for Mississippi State in their offensive third, but a missed opportunity there as the pass was off the line intended for Sullivan. Addie Tomlin, number 14, set to get it in as both teams getting some substitutions in. Graff and Trigley in for the Gators with 17:57 to play. It's not easy on Sunday in the SEC, especially if you're a team like Mississippi State and you're playing on the road, because that's been one of the real changes this year to the conference has been the travel schedule. It seemed like it was a little better aligned in previous years as we see Triglia get out to Silver. They tried to feed it through back to Triglia. But you talk about the travel for Mississippi State all the way from Tuscaloosa to Gainesville, just not the normal South Carolina-Florida trip that you saw in recent years.
No, I think that the travel partners was something that these players got used to. I think the coaches got used to it. It was easy travel arrangements because most of the teams were in close proximity to each other. I think this has been a huge adjustment for the players and the coaches to figure out a way to make Sundays easier, because if you have a long day of travel, whether that be on a bus or flying, it can mean these Sunday games are that much more difficult.
Leon. And Tricata standing over the ball. This one's straight on goal from about 12 yards out. And Leon's going to keep it and powers it right at the Bulldog wall. Leon's won the ball back, tries to send it into Triglia. Jillian Graff had an opportunity and said it's going to roll out of bounds. And Florida is going to have a, Mississippi State is going to have a throw in right near the corner with 16:01 to play. It is Florida. Tessa Andahar and Taylor Travis into the ball game. And a yellow card going against Jasmine Simmons. That's the second yellow card issued against the Bulldogs in the first half. And it's one of those things that we don't usually see it play a role in SEC play, but if Simmons is to get a second yellow card, then the Bulldogs would have to play a man down the rest of the ball game.
Yeah, I think that yellow card was just issued for her. Just, you know, I think she got a warning on some of the other fouls.
Oh my goodness. Janardine narrowly put it into her own goal.
No, this was a well-played ball into the box. You see this ball gets, it's got back, it's kind of spinning sideways, and Mississippi State did a good job to get something on it. I would have liked to have seen Rawson maybe call out for the ball a little bit to get possession of that.
Leon Sullivan had the deflection. Tessa Andahar in the corner trying to turn the corner. Plays it across the mouth of the goal, and just wide is the shot for Joe Dragata. Mike, and tune into SEC Football Tonight, presented by Regents Bank, a new show for SEC fans to get the very best news, analysis, and opinions on the SEC. Weeknights at 7 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Central, only on CSS, the face of college football in the South. Florida is outshot Mississippi State 7-0. early in this ball game. Here's Leon, and the Gators back on attack. Leon's going to try it outside the 18-yard box, and Rawson comes up big.
And that's something Mississippi State has to be accountable for. They have to know that Leon will take a 40-yard shot, and she can make a 40-yard shot. She does a great job here. She sees that window, and she just goes ahead and blasts it at the back of towards the back post. And fortunately for Mississippi State, it was wide, but she is a dangerous player anywhere near the 18.
13 saves against the Gators last year in the 1-0 win. Last year, she led the SEC ninth in the NCAA in saves with 131. But this year, she came into the weekend with just 68 saves. As the Bulldogs trying to defeat the Gators for the second consecutive year and beat them in 4-0, something that they've never done in the school's history prior. Sullivan trying to win the ball in the corner. Westfall headed it out of bounds. It'll be a throw-in with 13:10 to play. Pressure for the Bulldogs, and Hadiri pressuring the keeper up front. But Florida is going to move the ball across midfield. King draws the foul, free kick. Florida trying to not waste any time putting the ball back in play, but the referee holds up King. And I will see Christine Westfall, the freshman from Brecksville, Ohio, take the kick just inside midfield with just over 12 minutes to play. This one headed towards the far post, still bouncing around in the penalty area. Settled down by Andahar. Andahar blocked by Elizabeth Sullivan. Out of bounds. That's good defense by your leading scorer.
Yeah, it's always good when you have a forward that's not afraid to come back and win a ball. But I would like to see her attacking a little bit more.
An opportunity and a shot that's high for Claire Faulkner, the freshman from Dayton, Ohio.
You like your forwards to play defense, but you also want to make sure that they're getting themselves up ahead. But great job here by Florida. She does a great job of battling through and not giving up on a ball and then creating a great shot for herself.
The ninth shot of the ball game, Claire Faulkner. She is a member of the ESPN Class of 2012 forwards to watch list. Here comes the Bulldogs. Taylor, the freshman, lost possession. Leon gave it right back. Dana Forbes won it back. Tomlin trying to play it up. Hadiri lost her footing. And King's going to play it back to the keeper, Taylor Burke. Shelby Jordan will throw it in. Freshman from Jackson, Tennessee. Taylor back to Jordan. Forbes trying to settle it. As they're trying to find Taylor, but it just never came. Triglia to Andahar. Andahar with so much speed and so much room, as Sullivan comes back to play defense once again. And Elizabeth Sullivan, the forward, took it away and cleared it across midfield. Jordan stepped up against Leon, but it's out of bounds off her foot. Florida with a throw-in under 10 minutes to play.
Mississippi State is doing a good job individually defensively. They just need to figure out a way that once they win that ball from Florida, how to keep possession of it. They're, you know, Sullivan did a great job. She won the ball back, and then she just played it long to Florida's defense, and then all they do is just kind of reload their offense again. We need to see Mississippi State hang on to the ball a little bit more.
Dragata will take the free kick. Sending it towards the far post. Rawson in a crowd pulls it down once again. Not going to get the credit for the save here, but man, still a lot of guts here. Snatching it just out of the reach of two Gators that were in.
I know I thought she was a little high off her line, but she does a good job of going out and meeting the ball at the highest point and is able to pull it down before Florida could make it any more dangerous than it already was.
Get in front of it, Claire!
Jillian Graff. Leon. Claire Faulkner, this is Triglia at the top of the penalty area, giving it off. Graff, Leon, one-on-one, big time block there for Jana Dean. Helping out her keeper. And the whistle goes against Holly King. The Bulldog defense has done a good job of recovering. Janadine, the sophomore, with a free kick. Leon. King with plenty of room and 6:44 to play. Graff, Triglia, Leon, and a whistle and a handball against Zara Sayed, the senior from Indian Springs, Alabama.
And this is going to be a very dangerous free kick for Florida. Just outside the 18, Mississippi State and Rawson are going to have to make sure that they're very organized.
Dragata will take it over the crossbar. You can find out how your school's doing on the recruiting trail. Get the latest news and notes with In the Huddle. Join hosts Barton Simmons and Matt Stewart Tuesday at 6:30 p.m. on CSS, the face of college and high school sports in the South. Well, 5 minutes into the ball game, Erica Timrak and Mackenzie Barney combined for the first and only goal of the game. And I think the biggest thing that we saw, Cameron, out of the commercial break halfway through the first half was a little bit of insurgence of offense for Mississippi State. When they got the youth and the freshmen on the team, they've been a little bit more effective offensively, but they're still in search of their first shot of the ball game.
Yeah, I think they came out with a little more sense of urgency in that kind of second quarter.
Travis over the crossbar. That was the beauty of an effort set up there by the junior.
But Florida has still had chances, and that's just another one right here as Travis takes a touch inside, does a great job, gets her head up, sees where Rawson is, and goes ahead and fires one long just to make sure that she's staying on that line. But Florida's going to have to continue to be patient. They're going to have to continue to change the point of attack and not get too frustrated at, you know, they're creating chances. Now they just have to figure out how to get them in the back of the net.
McKee won the ball. Still trying to possess it. Angie's going to draw the foul. It's going to be called by Leon. Number 91, the transfer from Notre Dame. She had the game-winning goal in the 2010 NCAA Women's World Cup. Dangerous ball in the box.
It was a well-played ball in the box. Mississippi State did a good job of to flick it on, and then there was no one making any runs behind that initial run. And those are the little things that Mississippi State has to clean up in order to have more opportunities. They do a good job. They get a free kick. They play it into the box well. Now who's going to be the person that's going to step up and finish that?
Foul against Hania Hadary. 3 minutes to play. And the Gators up by a goal. Rawson. And a whistle against Florida. It will give the Bulldogs a free kick. Skylar Rawson again coming off her line. To help against, it seems like, numerous set piece opportunities. Not that that one completely a set piece from that far out, but she's really had to guard against the aerial assault of the Gators early in this ball game.
And when she's a goalkeeper that's not afraid to come out off her line, she's not afraid to be physical, and that's something that is a great asset to Mississippi State. You know, they've created some fouls and some set pieces for Florida, but they know that they have a solid goalkeeper back there that's not afraid to battle, and I think that's something that they can, that can allow them to be a little bit more physical on the field than maybe some other teams that don't have that much confidence in their goalkeeper.
Bulldogs are trying to find the feet of their leading scorer, Elizabeth Sullivan. And Sullivan won it back for the moment, but it's out of bounds off Triglia. And maybe an opportunity for the Bulldogs to get the equalizer here with a minute and a half to play. Sullivan trying to win it. Instead, Triglia earns possession. Only two Bulldogs have scored in SEC play, Elizabeth Sullivan and Haley Heltzley. So the defense has not been the issue for the Bulldogs. The scoring has been the problem.
You know, and Florida can be susceptible on counterattacks. You know, they like to send those numbers forwards. They like to send their outside backs forward. So that kind of leaves them vulnerable to counterattacks and to quick counterattacks at that. But that's what Mississippi State is lacking in. They're not able to quickly counter and keep possession of the ball. And that's how they're going to, I think that's how they're going to score on Florida. But they've got to figure out a way to do that. As soon as they win the ball back, how can they get forward as a unit? And how can they do that quickly?
30 seconds remaining in the first half.
Seconds ticking off. And this first half between the Gators and the Bulldogs. And it was the early opportunity created by Erica Timrak that will give the Gators the lead as they head into the locker rooms after 45 minutes of soccer. Mackenzie Varney with her fifth goal of the season. helping lead Florida to a 1-0 lead halfway through the ball game here on senior day. Florida leading the SEC overall picture in search of their 12th SEC regular season championship. We're joined with the head coach of the Florida Gators, Becky Burley. Becky, happy birthday, first of all.
Thank you very much.
What's your thoughts on the way your team played in the first half?
Well, I thought we started out well, but it deteriorated a little bit. You know, for us, we've just got to keep the ball moving and keep passing and keep possession. And we did not do a very good job of that in the first half. And we'll be talking a little bit about that at halftime.
One thing that, you know, we've talked about in the past with you guys is making sure you finish opportunities. But how are you getting your team to be patient? Because they are creating some opportunities, but now they just have to finish those. How do you encourage them to be patient?
Well, I mean, I think for us, patience comes again from possession. You know, when we keep the ball moving, their defense has to shift, and eventually we're going to find an opening that we can exploit.
Well, Coach, thank you so much. And happy birthday.
Thanks.
We appreciate you joining us.
Thank you.
Becky Burley, the head coach of the Florida Gators on senior day, 12th-ranked Florida, leading on Mackenzie Barney's goal at the half. We'll take a look around the SEC when we come back with four games of conference action still to play. We're at the half here in Gainesville, 12th-ranked Florida hosting Mississippi State. So glad to have you with us for SEC Soccer with Cameron Broom. I'm Bernie Gunther. We have four games left in the SEC regular season slate as we head towards Orange Beach, Alabama, and the SEC Soccer Tournament. And the two newcomers, Missouri and Texas A&M, they've made an impact here, and certainly they're going to make an impact in Orange Beach as well.
Yes, Texas A&M have been great, and Missouri have been great additions to the SEC, and it just shows that they're atop of both the Eastern and Western divisions.
Take a look at our SEC news and notes right now. It is Erica Timrak. Last week, she was named the co-offensive player of the week for the Florida Gators. It's senior day for her, and they also got a big win on Friday night, a 2-1 win against Missouri, and that's made a big impact in the standings.
Yes, and then defensive player of the week, Allie Hall, did a great job last week against Auburn, inking out a win for Tennessee.
Well, we have just four games remaining in the SEC regular season. We'll take a look around the league at some scores and more when we come back to Gainesville at the half between the Bulldogs and the Gators. Ranked Florida leading Mississippi State here on a Sunday in the SEC. Let's take a look around the league and get you caught up on what's happening in SEC action. Missouri bouncing back after their loss to Florida on Friday night. They defeated Alabama 2-1. Ole Miss also picking up a win. Texas A&M right on target, leading Vanderbilt. A big score there after 45 minutes of soccer. They're up 3-0. Kentucky leading Georgia, and elsewhere looking for scores in the Auburn, Arkansas, and LSU, Tennessee games 45 minutes in.
Those are, I think, you know, that's what we expected, and here we see the road to Orange Beach. I think this is what's the most important right here, is how many of these players that are down here at the bottom can make it into that top 10, and who's going to make those adjustments. And That's why today those 3 points are so important for Mississippi State to get them right back in the hunt as we go into the last part of the season.
Well, four games remain in SEC play, including the one today. The newcomers, Texas A&M and Missouri, following Florida with 22 and 21 points, respectively. But the big story at the bottom, South Carolina right now is the last team in, but Alabama, LSU, Georgia, all those teams really have a chance, and Mississippi State, they really need to get some wins if they're going to work their way into the tournament.
Yeah, I think any of those teams, you know, Alabama, LSU, and Georgia all have a great opportunity to get themselves in above South Carolina and maybe Arkansas and Vanderbilt. So it'll be interesting to see how the rest of the season pans out.
Well, we'll take a look at the first half highlights when we come back. The Bulldogs from Mississippi State trailing the Gators by a goal at the half. A lot happens in four blocks. Ben Hill Griffin Stadium will be the site of the Florida-South Carolina matchup next week. The O'Connell Center, the white building in the background, gymnastics, men's and women's basketball and swimming. McKeithen Stadium, home of baseball, and here at James G. Presley Stadium, the site of soccer and track and field. And in the first half, it was kind of like a track meet for Florida. They got off to a quick start 5 minutes into the game. Take a look at the first goal set up by Erica Timrak. Barney did a great job of moving Skylar Rawson off her line to create her fifth goal of the season.
Yeah, they did a great job to stay on sides, but they didn't just stop there. They were able to knock the ball in and really challenge Rawson in the air and on the ground. Mississippi State was able to get a couple of opportunities, and Taylor Burke came up with a save there. But the story really was Florida's chances. They kept battling. They kept taking shots from long range and then creating set pieces for themselves and really challenging Rawson, who has been up for the challenge so far today.
Well, and the biggest stat, the fact that Florida outshot Mississippi State 12-0, and I'm sure that's one of the biggest question marks right now for Neil McDonald, is what are they going to do to combine to get an opportunity for a shot on goal, or even a corner kick opportunity?
Right, that's how Mississippi State can get themselves right back into this game, is maybe creating some set pieces. You know, we look and we see the fouls are 11-7, so they're somewhat even. But can they create one of those opportunities where they can put the ball in the box and create some havoc around there and see if they can't put a ball in the back of the net?
And, of course, the big one, a chippy ball game. You see 11 fouls to 7 after the first half. A chippy soccer game, but there's the lone goal scorer, Mackenzie Barney, back on the field. We'll have the second 45 minutes of soccer when we come back. Sunday in the SEC, we're in Gainesville, where the Gators lead the Bulldogs by a goal. Back in Gainesville, Florida leading by a goal as we get set for the start of the second half. It's the time of the year that you want to be playing your best soccer. We're moving towards Orange Beach, Alabama, the SEC soccer tournament. And then, of course, the field of 64 will be revealed after that. And headed into this weekend, four teams are in the top 20 of the NCAA soccer RPI. Florida at 9, Missouri, Texas A&M at 12 and 13, and then a Tennessee team that's playing very good soccer. We saw them play last week at 14.
Yeah, I think this just shows you how tough the SEC is. When we can have four teams in the top 20 on the RPI, I think that is just, it is a tribute to how difficult, you know, this conference is. With the addition of Missouri and A&M, it just increases that much more. I think this is what is going to help us continue to get teams not only, you know, battling in the SEC tournament, but into that NCAA tournament and getting further along.
Florida's had a tough weekend the last two out, playing against Missouri, getting a win, playing on the road against Texas A&M, but they won both those games, and things set up where they control their own destiny to try to win their 12th SEC regular season title. They'll go to Alabama, play at Vanderbilt and at South Carolina. So the bad news for Becky Burley's team is they're going to be on the road trying to wrap up the 2012 championship. But it's always a good news, you remember back as a player, when you controlled your own destiny.
Yeah, it definitely is. I think she's happy where her team is right now. But I know that she's going to still command and demand that her team continues to play at this high level.
So Neil McDonald and his team, now they're coming out of the locker room after making their halftime adjustments. And they're right in this ballgame, trailing by a goal. And as we're joined by the head coach of the Bulldogs, Coach, first of all, your thoughts on what your team needs to do to get a little more offense in the second half.
Well, we need to do a better job of getting pressure on Florida in the middle of the park. I think that if we can do that, and then we just need to transition high and keep the ball a little bit better.
I think you have to be happy with the way your team did defensively. What do you think can make those adjustments in order to turn that defense into creating more of an offense for your team?
Well, our front three needs to transition quicker and higher to try to get some pressure on their back four. And if we can do that and then just really possess the ball simply with simple one and two touch play.
Coach, thanks for spending some time with us on our broadcast.
All right, thank you.
Neil McDonald, his ninth season at Mississippi State. Started off as a volunteer assistant in 2003. And assistant coach in 2003-2004, and the head coach in 2004. His team started off winning 8 games in a row before tying South Carolina. Then they won on a losing streak of 7 games in a row, but certainly some positives coming off of Friday night, a 3-2 win. And the good news is he played 45 minutes of soccer. You've been outshot 12-0, but in the score that really counts, you trail by only a goal.
Exactly. I think that shows you how these kids are still motivated. They still want to win. They still want to battle, that they were able to come back and not only tie the game up, but end up getting a win.
Second half underway. Florida possesses the ball early. Barney, her fifth goal of the season and the fifth minute, the difference so far, as Erica Timrak moved in to sole possession of fourth place in career assist in Florida history. And an early whistle a minute in against the Gators is going to give the Bulldogs a free kick. Janine Jane O'Dean, the sophomore from Scarborough, Ontario, puts it into possession. But it's got to be frustrating because it's almost like you gave the ball right back, but Florida's going to be called for the foul, and now Jane Adine's going to have another chance for a free kick.
Yeah, you heard Coach McDonald talk about keeping possession of the ball, and I think that's something that Mississippi State really needs to do. If you can't score unless you have the ball. So that's something that as they continue to build into the second half, they want to make sure they can string some passes together. And if they do lose the ball, try to win it right back in the attack.
Tomlin settles it on the ground to Simmons. Simmons tries to play it across. Maybe the best opportunity early on, and a shot at the equalizer. Hania Hadiri has tied the ball game 2 minutes in to the second half.
It's just a great job, and this is what we talked about. If they can get on the attack, and if they lose the ball, they win it right back. But Mississippi State does a great job of playing the ball into the box. It gets knocked around a little bit. Syed winds up the ball at her feet and goes ahead and blasts a shot, and it goes in for a goal. And that's what Mississippi State needs to do. They don't need to give up. They need to keep fighting and keep battling.
On the goal line, Mississippi State, the assist goes to number 16, Jasmine Simmons. And the goal to number 9,
Hania Hadiri. So Hania Hadiri with the goal for Mississippi State, and she is just the third Bulldog to score in SEC play in 2012. And it is amazing how quick the complexion of a game can change. Only a shot in the ball game, and that's all it's taken for the Bulldogs. And a little extra pressure there for Dana Forbes. And Forbes has called for the foul, and Florida will have a free kick. Westfall takes the free kick, drives it right at the line, and Rogers has the ball in some space, traveling towards the penalty area. Good defense by the Bulldogs. They've won possession back, and now they have a chance to counter. It's like a whole nother team for the Bulldogs as they tried to get it wide, looking for Taylor, the freshman. And finally, they'll find the feet of Taylor as Simmons makes a run.
Landon, it just seems that Mississippi State came out in the second half with a little bit more confidence. You know, they weren't shaken with a 1-0 loss, and they came out and they're battling, and they were able to create some opportunities just like this. Simmons does a great job. She plays this ball into the box, and all it takes is one person to just mistouch it for Florida, and if the ball falls to the feet of Hyatt, and she's able to put it in the back of the net for Mississippi State.
Florida trying to take back the lead. Here is Timrak. Danny Spies. Mackenzie Barney with a chance, and good defense inside the box for Grimes. Yeah. Trying to play it over the top. Here's Sullivan trying to run on it. Sullivan has the chance, and she kicks it flicking it over the crossbar. But man, of the Bulldogs come out energized the first 5 minutes of the second half.
They definitely did. I think they're playing more sense of urgency now. That goal, I think, gave them some confidence. Sullivan does a great job here. She battles around the outside of Rogers and sees that tiny little window. Unfortunately, she wasn't able to keep the ball down as much as I think she would have liked to, but it was a great opportunity for Mississippi State.
Grimes with a free kick. As we come upon 40 minutes to play in the ball game. Bulldogs have the Gators on their heels as Burke comes off her line to take it. The sixth goal of the season for Ahania Haderi, the freshman, evening the score 2 minutes into the second half in the 47th minute. Come on, we got it. Bulldogs trying to clear it. Salon played it off the feet of Tomlin. After zero shots in the first 45 minutes of soccer, the Bulldogs have outshot the Gators 2-0 here early on in the second half. Sullivan trying to find the loose ball. Forbes draws the foul against Salon.
You know, I think Florida, and in the second part of that first half and then now, I think they're not winning those 50-50 balls like they were in the first part of the first half. They were able to kind of dominate everything. They were anticipating every pass, and now they've kind of settled back a little bit. And I think they need to win more of those balls in the midfield and not just win them, but settle them in so they can find each other's feet.
Dangerous ball sent in. Madison McKee was tracking it for Mississippi State and said, here's Florida coming the other way, trying to counter. Barney trying to stay onside. Salon making a run as Timrak has possession. Tries to feed it into Barney, and the ball is going to be deflected for a goal kick. You can stay up to date with the experts of Southern College Sports. Like us on Facebook and follow us at CSS Sports on Twitter to get the latest news and programming updates. Leon is going to sub in for Barney. You can re-enter the game in college soccer in the second half if you're taken out. Here's Timrak pushing it towards the corner, creating some space. Timrak going for goal, playing it across the mouth of the goal, and it's going to be cleared out of bounds, but for a corner kick by Simmons. Look at how fast Florida puts it back into play. Leon playing it across the mouth of the goal. Andahar. Here's Sullivan, the leading scorer, playing it up top. Sullivan trying to track it down before it goes out of bounds. And they'll say it was last touched by the Gators. But how do you like this? It seems like still only three Bulldogs are pressed up as the ball comes in. And Sullivan's going to play it to Forbes. But you got to credit the Bulldogs. They possess the ball so much better in the second half to start.
Well, not only have they possessed the ball better, but they've taken advantage of their opportunities better. You've got to make sure that when you're creating opportunities, that you're creating good goal-scoring opportunities, and that's exactly what Mississippi State has done. They've kind of shaken the defense of Florida a little bit, gained some confidence, and now they've created a lot more opportunities in the second half than they did in the entire first half.
King settles it back down. Timrak. Cleared back across midfield. 10 minutes into the second half. Chipped out of bounds, and Florida is going to get a throw-in and some pretty good positioning here as Lauren Silver goes in to take it. Timrak on senior day. Bulldogs trying to play it up from the back. A very late whistle there as King went down. King, one of the five seniors being honored today. One-on-one opportunity. Rawson comes off the line. Ball still is loose, and it's going to be cleared out of bounds by Tomlin. But a great job of the Bulldog defense as Rawson was down well above the line.
I know, it's amazing what a great touch will do. And Spies has a tremendous touch right around the defender. Then Mississippi State comes out and defends her well. Not only does Ronson come out, but everyone else kind of fills in behind her, and they're able to keep the ball in the back of the goal. But another great opportunity for Florida and a great defensive job from Mississippi State.
10 minutes into the second half. The Bulldogs have outshot the Gators 2-0. And one of those 2 shots by Haderi has been the equalizer, and Mississippi State is going to be on the offense once again with a free kick near midfield. Physical play has been one of the big storylines in this game. For Mississippi State, Haderi, the third goal scorer in SEC play, with Elizabeth Sullivan getting the bulk of the goal scoring. Florida, meanwhile, has 5 Gators with 3 goals in SEC play alone. Leon fires it, but well off target.
You know, we talk about taking shots from outside the box, and I think it's always a good thing to occasionally do that. But I think that Florida needs to settle down and be a little bit more patient, try to kind of pick apart this Mississippi State defense and not just settle for those long-range shots. I think had Leon had her chance to take that back and maybe get in and go 1v1 with one of the Mississippi State defenders, I think she would.
Salon. Plenty of room. Misplayed it to Timrak, who chases it, but it's going to roll out of bounds for a Bulldog throw-in. Sullivan, the leading scorer. She had the lone goal against Florida last year, and she battles against Holly King, and she's going to be called for the foul. Florida wastes no time to put the ball back in play. Combining Spies. Timrak trying to chase on it. And this ball is going to be deflected, and look at Leon tracking it down before it rolls out of bounds. Leon gives it off to Salon. Salon inside the box. Salon still possessing it, looking for some help. This is Andahar. Andahar with great patience. And Andahar is going to earn the Gators a corner kick.
of that. Someone would get in, and then they'd cut the ball back. They'd play it to somebody else who would then get in line again and realize they didn't have anything, cut the ball back. And that just, the result was a corner kick, and that's another tremendous thing that Florida's able to do. They're confident in their possession, and so they're able to be patient.
Spies all alone. This one bended well. And Silver has it inside the penalty area. That one's off the crossbar. Still inside the penalty area, and Spies will watch it roll out of bounds. It'll be a throw-in for Florida inside their offensive third. Andahar finds the feet of Spies. Salon. King. Salon's all alone, chipping it across. Maybe a little miscommunication there, but Silver works well to win the ball back for Florida. Timrak finds the feet of Dragata. Up to Annie Spies. And Leon fires it away. You can tune in to CSS this fall to catch live NCAA football from the SEC, Conference USA, Sun Belt, and more. Plus, catch your favorite SEC and ACC teams throughout the week on College Football Replays. Visit CSS-sports.com for complete schedules and updates. The first two shots of the second half for the Gators coming on that last possession. And Timrak going back to work, but a good slide tackle by Jane O'Dean, taking the ball out of bounds. Florida trying to regroup. Salon. Andahar creates some space, tracking right towards the goal, and Andahar fires the shot, and Rawson makes a diving grab to make the save.
Not something that Coach Burley talked about at halftime, was making sure that they keep the ball moving and they keep changing the point of attack, and that was a great job by Florida there. They start on one side of the field. They're able to come over. The ball winds up with Andujar. She does a good job of taking someone on 1v1, which then creates space for herself. She looks up, sees that she has an opportunity to take a shot, and goes ahead and takes it. And that's the kind of thing that Florida needs to do. They need to make sure that they're patient in changing the point of attack, and then once they see an opportunity, going at it and taking people on.
Rawson had 6 saves against Alabama. Entered today with 323 career saves. Just 45 back of Taryn Holland, the top spot in Mississippi State's record book for saves. So she's been so active. And just as we talked about at the onset, we knew if Mississippi State was going to have an opportunity, that she was going to need to make some great plays, and she has today.
Yeah, she definitely has. She's come up big for them throughout the season, and today is another good example of that.
The Gators have outshot the Bulldogs 16-2, but just 4-2 in the second half. Fired shot over the crossbar, the 17th shot of the ball game, fired by Adriana Leon. The game-winning goal in the NCAA title match. Missed the first 3 UF matches playing with the under-20 Canadian national team at the FIFA under-20 World Cup in Japan.
Stop the clock!
Julie Waddle is going to sub in for Mississippi State. The senior from Vicksburg, Mississippi. There she is, number 30, a 5'7 senior defender. And Shelby Jordan, the 5'5 freshman, will come off the field in a little bit of pain.
Oh,
Here's King. Adairi, the lone goal scorer for the Bulldogs, had possession, but she didn't have any help. And Florida's won it back. Beautiful ball fed through to Salon. Tried to find the feet of Chimrak. Instead, we see Taylor having the ball stripped away. Silver towards the end line, playing it across. Grimms trying to get it out of there. Silver still with possession. Trying to cut it back. And the Bulldog defense still able to hold on and deny Silver a chance at the cross.
They have done a good job defending 1v1. Anytime Florida has sent someone in, they've done a great job of battling in there and kind of making sure that everything's solid defensively. But, you know, the one thing that we've talked about throughout this game is it's been a very, very chippy match. There have been a lot of fouls, and I think that that's something that's going to continue on for the next 25 minutes. These two teams want to win this game, and you can see that as they continue to get more and more physical.
Hanieh Hadary, the lone goal scorer in the game, is the third recipient of a yellow card for the Bulldogs. So three yellow cards have been issued against Mississippi State. Look at the footwork there by King, using her body to keep possession. Cleared out of bounds by Jane O'Dean. King looking for options on the throw-in. Here's Salon. Leon, wide open look, played it across, made a little too selfless, if you will, there, but Timrak's gonna track it down. Timrak with some fancy footwork. Timrak creates the opportunity, and Jen O'Dean deflects it out of bounds. Florida has a throw-in.
And that's one thing about Erica Timrak that's fun to watch. She loves to take people on 1v1. She loves to make people look foolish at times. But she's so sound technically. I think it's something that Coach Burley is going to miss from her next year, is just that flashy little player that Erica Timrak has been known for.
Headed out of bounds, another Gator corner kick. This time, Timrak. He's going to take it all alone from the far corner. Driven towards her near post and out of bounds, it'll be a Florida throw-in. She finds the feet of Silver. Everybody back defending for Mississippi State. Here's Timrak going to goal. Timrak plays it across, and it'll go out of bounds, and Timrak has earned her second corner kick in as many tries.
She did a good job there, too. Instead of going in line, and if you noticed, all of the Mississippi State players kind of backed out a little bit because they thought she was going to drop it. She went ahead and took that shot near post and made Rawson dive to create that save.
This one towards the far post. King had a chance, but it'll go over the crossbar, and the threat is over for Skylar Rawson. But how about this start for Mississippi State? Hania Hadera, the freshman, just 2 minutes in, fires a strike, and we're tied at a goal apiece with 22:34 to play here in Gainesville.
I taught environmental law at LSU.
Well, it's been a completely different team for Neil McDonald in the second half. 2 minutes into the ball game, Hadary had the equalizer, and with just 22:33 to play, it's a 1-1 ball game, as his goalkeeper, Skylar Rawson, has really helped keep Mississippi State in the ball game. The Bulldogs have been outshot by 15 in this game, and Florida in possession once again, flicking it around. Leon plays it across, and it's cleared out of bounds by Shannon Palmer, but another corner kick coming for the Gators. It's Lisa Leon, get it back in quickly. And Andujar watches, it was taken away by Sullivan, and here comes the Bulldogs trying to counter, taken away by Maloney. Now out wide, Heltzley, one of three goal scorers in SEC play for Mississippi State. But just as the threat started, it ends, and Florida trying to take their time. They are so patient in their attack. And sometimes maybe it goes to say that it seemed maybe too patient sometimes as well.
Well, I think not necessarily patient, I think is the right word, but they don't have that sense of urgency or that little bit of fire that we know Florida can play with. And I think that if they can play with a sense of urgency and be patient in picking and choosing their times to go forward, I think they will be more successful in this game.
Corner kick once again for the Gators. And Tim Rack in the corner. And that one is going to roll out of bounds. Florida will get another chance. As Palmer throws it out. Spies standing towards the far post. Tim Rack had a chance off the edge of her foot, and it's going to be another Gator corner kick as Rawson got a hand on it, but it rolled out of bounds.
Yeah, this ball gets played in, and Mississippi State, you know, initially thought they did enough to clear it out, but Timrak just is able to figure out a way to create another opportunity for Florida.
Spies again bending towards the far post. Timrak tried to settle it. Timrak trying to dribble through the Mississippi State defense, and the ball still in the danger area. And finally a shot, and a goal! Joe Dragata fires a bullet outside the penalty area, takes one crack at it, and puts Florida back up top.
That's what we talked about with Florida, making sure that, you know, they hustled every 50-50 ball. They won all the 50-50 balls. The ball squirts out here to Joe Dragata. She blasts a ball from about 35 yards out in the upper 90. Rawson didn't have a chance to save that one. Great job by Joe Dragata.
Dragata with her fourth goal in SEC play and her fourth goal of the season. She finds the upper 90 and puts Florida back on top.
And she has to be happy, you know, senior day and all. Two seniors have scored the goals for Florida. Their patience has paid off.
And the goal goes to number 14.
Andy Spies credited with the assist.
And that makes it score Florida.
And the Bulldogs will be in search of their equalizer once again. Here comes Sullivan racing with numbers. Amy Hoover also moving up. Here is Sullivan, still with possession, trying to take on the entire Gator defense. Tried to give it off to Hoover. Instead, Taylor Travis had the defense and was able to clear it away. That's where, if you're the Bulldogs and you're a Bulldog fan, you wish that Sullivan just had a little bit of help up there.
Yeah, and they've done well to keep better possession this half than they did in the first half, but now they just have to make sure that as they keep that possession, they build as a unit. As Sullivan makes that run down the sideline, she needs to have help filling in behind so that she has someone to play the ball off to. Or if she goes ahead and takes a shot, someone to kind of get any deflection that may come off the goal.
Whistle and a free kick coming for Florida.
Get in the box! Get in the box! In front, Kristen.
Joe Dragata. Her fourth goal of the season. We'll dummy it, and here's Spies playing it to Dragata, racing towards the line. Dragata plays it across the mouth of the goal. And Rawson able to fist it out.
And a great job by Rawson, because had she not, Leon was flying in on that backside, ready to score that goal, had it not been just barely touched by Rawson.
Sullivan. Not a good touch. Florida wins it back. Try to chip it forward to Andahar. Instead, here's Amy Hoover playing it up to Sullivan. Sullivan finding McKee. McKee with some space, playing it wide as the Bulldogs try to get in on the attack. Leon gives it to Spies in midfield, trying to play it through, looking for Timrak, and good defense there for Tomlin, clearing it away. Salon chipped it over the top. Let's take another look at the fourth goal of the season by Joe Dragata, the senior from Tampa.
Yeah, Spies does a good job. She battles and just barely taps this ball to Dragata, who is able to one-time it in the back of the net. She was so composed, even as that ball is coming at her and defenders are coming towards her. She was composed enough to be able to get a really solid shot.
One of the five seniors in search of their collective would be third SEC regular season title. Last year it was South Carolina on the final day of the season, pulling the upset off against Florida to win that title and end the streak. But with wins against Missouri and Texas A&M, the senior class in some ways does control their own destiny down the stretch, because they do enter this last four-game period with a little bit of a buffer point-wise, but it's a battle in the SEC, and you know every game is gonna be a challenge as Barney, who scored the first goal of the game, gives it back. Andahar. Leon. Trying to combine. It'll be a Florida throw in with 14:24 to play. Leon. Going right to goal. Leon. Gets the deflection out of bounds, and Florida has yet another corner kick opportunity. Andahar, with a lot of room, fires it on goal. Timrak goes down, and they're gonna have a whistle. They'll mark it just outside the penalty area.
You know, and that just goes to show how dangerous Mississippi State knows that Erica Timrak can be. They know that they can't allow her to just dribble freely in the box, so they go ahead and take her down. Luckily for them, it was outside the box, but you know, I know Coach McDonald would rather them just be more sound defensively and keep numbers behind the ball and not allow her to get in a situation where they do need to make a foul like that.
Timrak will take the free kick. She's got a goal. The goal along with an assist. And the Gators are up two. Erica Timrak, her fourth goal of the season on senior day.
She does a great job. She sets this up well. Spies runs over the ball. She just goes ahead and notices that Bronson is in the middle of the goal, leaving that backside wide open. She does a great job. She keeps it low and on frame, which is always what you want when you take a set piece. Great job by Erica Timrak.
Well, Erica Timrak, four goals, five assists. assists, 13 points on the season. Entered the game seventh all time in Gator history. Only 7 points behind today, Annis. But she's picked up a couple points here today. It's closer to maybe moving up in history. So both Skylar Rawson and Erica Timrek moving up their respective teams' historic polls, if you will, as Florida back on the move. Timrek trying to create some space. Playing it out wide. Here is the defender, Travis, getting in on the attack. Barney was making a run. She was open, but Taylor Travis taking her time with Florida up by 2 goals and 11:40 to play. Andahar. Mackenzie Barney with all types of room to work. Tried to cut it in, but it's played back to her feet. And then finally, Morgan Grimes plays it upfield. And now an opportunity possibly for the Bulldogs to counter. Hadari, the lone goal scorer, trying to find the ball, and she does. Gives it off to Sullivan. Sullivan takes a crack at it, but it's wide of the net. Let's take another look at the goal by Erica Timrak.
You know, one thing you don't want to do is create set pieces just outside the box, and I know that they felt like they had to do this, but Erica Timrak is so talented on set pieces. She did what every coach wants, and that's keeping the ball low and on frame. Because if nothing else, the ball could get batted back out into the box and you want your teammates running in to finish that. But they didn't even need that this time because she went ahead and put it in the back of the net.
Barney settles it. Gets it off to Timrak. She's got a goal and an assist. Perfectly fed through to Faulkner. And Faulkner goes down. A whistle. And Florida is going to have a penalty. And a red card issued to Skylar Rawson.
A red card has been issued to Mississippi State's number one, Skylar Rawson.
And so CJ Winship, the sophomore transfer from Ridgeland, Mississippi, went to UAB, is going to come in. As the Bulldogs are going to have to play a man down the final 9:52. And Florida has their fourth goal as the penalty's converted.
A tough situation for any keeper to come in and have to, the first thing they have to do is take a PK. Dragata does a good job. She keeps it low, which is always difficult for keepers to get to, and Flora is able to get up another goal.
So Dragata picks up goal 4 and 5 on the season. All 5 of her goals have come in SEC play.
Off the quarter goal, it goes to number 14.
And Florida in some way shows a little bit of their resilience, especially the way Mississippi State opened up the second half with a goal scored 2 minutes in. And he got the sense, especially that first 5 minutes with the momentum that Mississippi State had, that it could be a different ball game from what we saw the first 45 minutes.
Well, that's what makes Florida so dangerous, is that, you know, you think that you've figured them out, and they come out and they score 3 goals on you. And it's always difficult to play them because they are so talented. They're very quick. They're very physical. And so anytime you think, oh, you know, maybe we figured out how we can stop them, and you get up, you get a goal or you tie the game, then they can just rally back down and put 3 more up on you.
Trimley puts it in play quickly. Some substitutions coming into the game. We are going to see Florida seniors come off. Mackenzie Barney, Joe Dragata, Erica Timrak, and Holly King. And of course, the other one, Catherine Williamson, watching from the bench. made such a big impact. Here is Travis giving it a go. The 23rd shot of the game. It's amazing to think about the ups and downs of the season. Becky Burley giving this Gator team maybe one of the most challenging non-conference schedules that they've ever played in the history of the program. And they started off the season losing in Miami 4-1. Then they went on the road, tied North Carolina, but the game that maybe changed the season for them was a 3-2 overtime win against a Duke team that that time was ranked number 2 in the country. And I feel like this team maybe started to believe in themselves at that moment.
Yeah, I think they were able to gain some confidence from that when you play well and you're able to put some passes together and create a game that you feel like you've played your best. I think that just shows you how impactful you can be going into the future. And I think they had a lot of confidence coming into the SEC. They had played Texas A&M, they had played Missouri in previous years, so they knew what they were expecting. It wasn't anything different for them. And I think playing games like that against Duke, that just is a confidence booster for your team.
There's a little bit of a rocky start for Florida, losing their first SEC game to Kentucky, and they had a narrow victory against Auburn in overtime. But after that, the team started to come together, and you talk about some of the changes for Florida. You know, they've been equally as effective shooting the ball in the first half and the second half. But the big story there is you talk about how good their defense and their possession is, holding Mississippi State to only 3 shots in this game.
Yeah, I think the only thing that you can say that is unfortunate is that one of those 3 shots that they held them to went in for a goal. But I think they have to be otherwise very happy with the way that they played, especially in the second half. I think in the first half they, you know, had a little bit of a letdown. They weren't settled into playing the style that they like to play. But I think definitely in the second half they have to be happy with the result they've gotten.
Lindsay Cooper recently subbed into the ball game, possessing it. Travis trying to settle it down. Travis playing it across the mouth of the goal. Graff had a chance. Instead, it's going to be cleared upfield as a late whistle comes in. And it'll give the Bulldogs a free kick as Grace Irby, the freshman from Germantown, Tennessee, made the great defensive play. Tatiana Perez battling, offside's flag is up. It'll be a free kick for the Bulldogs with 4:40 to play in the ball game.
Caroline, you just
go drop this on the 6. I thought the offside flag was up. Instead, it will be a free kick for Florida. Trigley will take it, sending it towards the far post, and it's stuck right through to Skylar Rawson. It's football season across the South. CSS and Tony Sachrace are teaming up again this season, featuring 10 great recipes from fans across the South. Visit css-sports.com and vote for your favorite recipe today. I think it's going to be an interesting last couple of weeks, and certainly a very interesting tournament in Orange Beach, the largest tournament, obviously, that the SEC's ever had, a whole new round. It's going to start on Monday and go the entire week with 10 teams invited. But I think that you talk about the complexion. Obviously, you've seen Missouri and Texas A&M come in and play all the sports in the Southeastern Conference. But in soccer, they may have made one of the bigger impacts of all the sports because of how good they've traditionally been, as this ball played across to Perez, and Perez fires a shot, and Rawson able to cover it up.
Yeah, I think that the impact that A&M and Missouri have made in this conference will only help lift these teams. You want to make sure that you're getting really quality teams when you add teams into your conference. And I think, you know, across the board that soccer, you're right, is one of those where it's made an immediate impact. And it's good to see the RPIs of these teams going up and showing that this is a conference that can really dominate in the NCAA tournament. And hopefully we'll battle in this SEC tournament, and then we'll be able to get some more teams into the NCAA conference that'll go a little bit further than we have in the past.
Excuse me, that was C.J. Winship, who's in goal now. Obviously, Rawson got the red card earlier. Transfer from UAB. Florida's keeper, Taylor Burke. Andahar. Graff. And it's cleared by Simmons up the field and out of bounds with 90 seconds to play. And C.J. Winship comes off her line. Winship gets set to punt away. Four goals for the Gators. Joe Dragata coming up with two. And Florida's gonna move to 8-0 all time against the Bulldogs here in Gainesville. And Simmons is gonna go down with just 13 seconds to play.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2.
It'll hop in the hands of Taylor Burke, and Becky Burley and the Gators are going to walk away with a 4-1 win over the Bulldogs. Got to credit Neil McDonald's team the way they came out after the halftime, making the adjustments with Hadari scoring the equalizer, but Burley's Gators came right back and were able to score three goals in the second half.
Yeah, I think Coach Burley is happy with the way this result ended. And, you know, you can attest it to being senior day that she probably went in and, you know, told them that she wanted to make sure that they won. And they did.
A win for the seniors on senior day. Florida wins it 4-1. For Cameron Broom and our entire CSS crew, Bernie Gunther saying so long from Gainesville, where the Gators get a victory over the Bulldogs by three goals.